Our Old Testament lesson this morning is about God's promises to Abraham and about Abraham's struggle to trust in God. God shows Abraham the stars and promises that Abraham and Sarah will have descendants, not just a single heir, mind you, but descendants, plural, as numerous as the great number of stars that they can see spread across the night sky. Have you ever stopped to count the stars in the sky? On a clear night, far away from the lights of civilization, there seem to be millions. As a student, I once drove across country with a friend of mine to a wedding in Washington State. At one point in the trip, we found ourselves rolling along in the wee hours of the morning, somewhere around 2 or 3 a.m., somewhere in the middle of Montana, where the land is beautiful and the sky is big, but where there really isn't much other than cows and grass. I decided to pull over and take a break in a spot that was miles from anywhere. There were no other cars on the highway at that hour, and we had the place to ourselves, and it was dark. There were no streetlights, no neon signs, no city lights to drown out the starry night above. I turned off the car and killed the headlights and stood there under a canopy of brilliance that literally stretched unencumbered from horizon to horizon. The band 10,000 Maniacs recorded a song back in the late 80s entitled "The Painted Desert," in which Natalie Merchant sings the line, "The stars were so many there, they seemed to overlap." That line describes what I saw that night perfectly. When Abraham walked outside his tent and looked up into the sky, I imagine that he saw something similar to what I saw that night in Montana. Nothing but 1,000 jewels spread across the inky void. But for Abraham, it would have been a sobering moment, a visually stunning confirmation of God's promise to him and his wife, that his descendants would be as numerous as those uncountable orbs of light that stretched to infinity above him. But the problem was that God had made this promise to Abraham before. And while Abraham wanted to believe what God was telling him, he was having a hard time with it because of one simple fact. The evidence didn't seem to support the truth of what God was telling him. Have you ever had to wait for something for an extended period of time that you began to wonder if it was ever really going to happen? Abraham and Sarah knew that feeling. They had been unable to have children, and in that time and place, having children meant survival and the continuation of your family into the next generation. Without children, there was no one to help tend the flocks and till the fields. And in your old age, there was no one to care for you, and there was no one to inherit your family's property after you died. Large families were also important for reasons of safety. A large family could provide many eyes to stand watch and even help in defending off other tribes that might try to infringe your lands or steal from your herds. Having many children also would be a point of public pride. Conversely, being barren and without children was a sign that a family had been cursed by God in some way. So as hopeful as was God's promise, Abraham and Sarah grew more and more despondent with each passing year as it produced no children. Yet God promises. Now, in spite of this waiting and this despondence over the lack of children, the story of Abraham and Sarah to this point has been one of great blessings. They are wealthy and have many servants and have claimed victories over enemies who've threatened them. Life for them is good, but being childless is the characteristic that describes their lives. Even in the face of promise, there is only at that moment old age and childlessness. Noted Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann says of this passage, "It is part of the destiny of our common faith that those who believe the promise and hope against barrenness nevertheless must live with the barrenness." And so in the passage we read this morning, God reiterates to Abraham the promise that he will father a great nation, saying, "Your reward will be great." But Abraham responds to God not with renewed faith and a statement of confidence in this God who keeps promises, but with questions and signs of doubt. "O Lord God," Abraham cries, "what will you give me, for I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir." Now, from where we sit, It might be hard to understand how Abraham could doubt God, but we have the benefit of knowing how the story turns out. Abraham did not. And in that moment, considering their years of unrewarded waiting and based on all the evidence at hand, Abraham had questions. Have you ever doubted God's promises for you? Some of you may find it sacrilege for me to say so, but I have. The scriptural promises of the peaceable kingdom where the lion and the lamb shall lie down together and a little child shall lead them often seem very far removed from the troubled and sometimes violent world that we live in. Jesus said that the kingdom of God is right here in our midst, and we affirm that while the kingdom has not yet come to completion, the kingdom of God is a very present reality. Yet the empirical evidence often seems to suggest otherwise. So when I hear Abraham question God about when and where and how long it will take for that promise to be kept, I think I understand a little. But then Abraham goes out to look at the stars. And in that moment, something happens. What? The writer of Genesis tells us that Abraham believed. But the Hebrew here can be translated either believed or trusted. And while they may seem to be the same word, I think that what Abraham did was begin to trust the promise-making God, even though he was struggling to believe that the promise would ever come true. See, for me, there's a subtle difference there between belief and trust. I believe that the sun will come up tomorrow. I trust Neil deGrasse Tyson when he tells me why that will happen. I believe that I am a handsome man. I trust my wife when she tells me that it's so. Leslie Weatherhead once wrote that truth cannot be imposed from without, but must be revealed to the heart and to the mind within. In other words, we can only believe what our hearts and minds hold to be true. Likewise, John Calvin defines faith as the knowledge of God and of God's love and mercy towards us that is both revealed to our minds and sealed upon our hearts through the Holy Spirit. We cannot believe something because we are told to believe it. We can only believe it when it appeals to our minds as true. Belief does not come from without. It is a work of the Spirit within. See, if I tried to convince you that Southeastern Conference football is superior to Big Ten football, you would reject the very idea, no matter how compelling my argument was. If Jesus of Nazareth himself walked into this room through those doors and told you that the Ohio State University, was not the greatest university in the world, many of you would feel compelled to run him out of here on a rail. Now, you might say that you agree with him because, after all, he is the Son of God, but your heart wouldn't be in it. Your lips might say the words, but your mind would not believe they were true. Even after viewing the stars and coming to what the translators tell us is belief in verse 6, Abraham responds to God's promise in verse 7 with questioning doubt again in verse 8. So how could Abraham believe and still express doubt? What we are seeing is that Abraham has a hard time believing that the promises will be fulfilled, but he trusts in the God who makes the promise, and that trust is credited to him as righteousness. In our New Testament reading this morning, we heard the story of a father desperate to have his son healed. It may have been the same father we read about last week, only this time retold in a slightly different context with slightly different details by the gospel writer Mark instead of Luke. Jesus says to the man, "All things can be done for one who believes," to which the man replies, "I believe, help my unbelief." That line always gets to me, because here's a man who's being told that his level of trust may be the difference in whether or not his son can be healed. How horrifying to think that your children may pay the price for your own basic human doubts. I believe, help my unbelief. Here in these five simple words lie the faith experience of almost every single believer who's ever walked the planet. I believe, help my unbelief. Abraham had doubts and questions, but he didn't suddenly decide that God made a more compelling argument. Abraham decided to trust in God, even if he didn't fully believe everything being promised to him. I believe, help my unbelief. Who among us has not wondered or questioned? Who among us has not considered the empirical evidence and questioned whether God really is working out God's purposes in the world or not? I believe, help my unbelief? Who has never pleaded for an answer to prayer? Who has never felt like the old African-American minister, a veteran of the Jim Crow South and the Civil Rights Movement, who said, until you've stood for years knocking at a locked door, your knuckles bleeding, you do not really know what prayer is. I believe. Help my unbelief. In this season of Lent, we acknowledge the ways in which we fall short of the glory of God. In these 40 days, we will consider the ways in which we have sinned against God and one another, and we'll repent. Or at least we'll try. We will look at our world and see the ways in which we as a people have broken God's laws and failed to recognize the image of God in one another. We will do so with the promise that God is ever moving towards us, ever reaching out to us, ever trying to reconcile God's self to us. But many of us will struggle to believe that promise because our own experience says otherwise. Our own experience is one devoid of forgiveness and mercy. When we do wrong in this society, after all, we don't get off scot-free. There is a price to be paid. Yet God's promise is a promise of grace, of forgiveness, of mercy, and reconciliation. I believe. Help my unbelief. Walter Brueggemann writes again that this story of Abraham announces afresh what it means to be the creatures that we were created to be, that is, to be righteous. It means to trust God. It means to trust God's future and to live assured of that future, even in the deathly present. So when we find ourselves doubting the promises of God, when the evidence at hand seems to suggest to our minds that God's promises will never be fulfilled, we are in good company. For even so great a hero of the faith as Abraham did the same. But in those moments when questions arise, we need not feel as though our faith is weak. Faith, after all, contains a healthy dose of doubt. Were it not so, they would call it certainty. But we can be comforted by the fact that others before us and others that come after us will struggle to believe and to trust the depth of God's love for us, the breadth of God's mercy towards us, the height of God's grace for us. And if we have doubts, we have doubts. But even if we struggle to believe the promises, we can choose to trust in the God who has always kept promises, no matter how long we may have to wait. Such is the nature of God. Such is the nature of faith. To God be all honor, glory, power, and dominion in this world and in the world that is to come. Amen.